Good evening. Welcome to the July 27, 2015 Selectmen's Meeting. Please join me for the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, in liberty and justice for all. Tonight we have public hearings. Oh, he is going to join us.
Oh, good.
RSA 674:40-A Street Acceptances to name as Class 5 highways under the provisions of RSA 647:40-A the following named street platted by the Planning Board on March 16, 1985 and recorded at the Rockingham Registry of Deeds as Plan Number D-23791:West Ridge Road. 2, to accept as Class 5 highways the following recorded at Rockingham Registry of Deeds as Plan Number D-135685, Hemlock Street, 1,835 square feet parcel of area of roadway dedication. 3, to accept as Class 5 highways the following Rockingham Registry of Deeds as Plan Number D-23884:5, right-of-way relocation of Birch Road, Pine Road, and Hutchinson's Drive. 4, to accept as Class 5 highways the following Rockingham Registry of Deeds as Plan Number B-25144 and Plan Number D-23717 Alexander Drive. To accept a Class 5 highway under the provisions, the following named street platted by the Planning Board on August 4th, 1998 and recorded at the Rockingham Registry of Deeds as Plan Number D-26480:Fielding Lane. 6, to accept as Class 5 highways the following named street platted at the Planning Board and recorded at the Rockingham Registry of Deeds as Plan D-26794 Janet Lane. 7, to accept as Class 5 highway under the provisions of RSA 674 the following street named street platted at the Planning Board and recorded at the Rockingham Registry of Deeds as Plan Number D-27217 Wayside Farm Lane. Mr. Welch.
A mouthful, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, these are all roads that have been properly platted under the statute, RSA 674:40-A, by the Planning Board and recorded in the Registry of Deeds. There was a notice posted regarding this hearing. The issue here is to accept these roads, they've been maintained by the town for many years, but were never officially recorded as town roads.
Would anyone?
I have an objection. I haven't had a chance to go through all these, but I do object to number 3, and I think that should be pulled. That was accepted by town meeting vote on the warrant on March 14th, 1995. And nothing supersedes the vote of the town meeting.
Except the statute.
Well,
once platted by the Planning Board after the town meeting accepted the statute, which is in 1994, only the selectmen can accept a public right-of-way. As long as it's platted by the Planning Board and recorded in the registry.
Even after the town meeting vote.
The selectmen by statute, because it's the town meeting established that in 94.
Okay.
That's why we put it on, because we didn't want to have a question.
Is there anyone out there in the public that would like to speak to this? Seeing none, coming back to the board, Mr. Waddell?
I'm set.
Mr. Bridle?
I'm all set.
No comments, sir.
No. Okay, so...
closing the public hearing at what time?
I don't...
Well, you want a time to close the hearing.
7:04.
Closing the public hearing.
Excellent.
Next, we move on to public.
I'll make a motion on number 1 through 7 that we accept these streets as presented.
we don't have to have another hearing now.
I'll second that.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
I'm going to abstain.
4-4, one abstention. Moving on to public comment. Anyone here wishing to offer public comment? Seeing none, we'll move on to announcements and community calendar. Mr. Waddell?
No, I don't have anything. I just want to apologize for my attire. I just got here late. It was traffic coming up from Boston. Didn't have time to change.
Are you coming? Yep. Thank
you're
you
just advertising the beach.
That's it.
And Mr. Bridle?
No, I'd just like to let people know of the golf tournament for the Experience Hampton Group on August 10th. That golf tournament supports our Christmas parade in town. And if you'd like to golf or you'd like to sponsor or support that in somehow, you can kindly give Mr. Nyan a phone call. And I'm sure he will be more than willing to help you out in that fashion. Thank you.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Yes. Last Monday, Monday morning, I had the pleasure of attending the hair cutting ceremony at Station 1. And great turnout and a wonderful spirit. And Principal David O'Connor from the junior high was there, the academy, sorry about that, was there as well. And it was a wonderful occasion with really great warm feelings there. So I was very impressed and thoroughly happy that I was able to attend. Second item I have is I have been checking on a few things in neighborhoods lately, and I will send out a plea. Please put numbers on your homes. The homes without street numbers on them is scary. If there's an emergency and fire and police need to get to you, especially in the middle of the night, you really, really want visible numbers by your front door or wherever you can put them so you can see them from the street. We've really got to be more aggressive about putting identifying property numbers on the buildings.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Condolences to the Bennett family on their loss, their most recent loss. A great Hampton family, great business owner, grandfather, denizen, just a really swell guy. So condolences to them, and our thoughts are with them. A shout out to a couple of Marine colonels. One is Paul Lassard and his family, a longtime public servant, and he's in Portsmouth. He's living over there now and doing his thing. And his brother-in-law, Lieutenant Colonel Jack Vogt, both couple of Marines. It did a lot of heavy lifting over in the Asia theater during the Vietnam War, and we wish them and their families very well. Saw Mr. Russ Merrill this afternoon on Academy Ave. He looks great. He sends his regards to the community, and Dean was on, not to be confused with Bean, on the Toby and Merrill board. Dean hit the 6-0-H, and I think that's 60. So we all wish the Merrills, particularly Dean, a happy birthday. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Next, we move on to the consent agenda. First, we have a request of no objection for outdoor service for the galley hatch. 2, a solicitation permit. 3, entertainment activities. Cloud 9, Smutty Nose, use of town property for electronic sign for Seacoast Century weekend bicycle event. 5, parade and public gathering license. A, post 35 global war on terrorism for theirs for 9/11. The Seafood Festival, the Seacoast Century Weekend Bicycle Event, and the Seacoast Festival Vendor's License, A, Zach's Barn, 275 Ocean Boulevard, 7, poll petitions, Unitil, 8, deed waiver for 2 parcels of land.
Motion to accept the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
I have questions.
Yes.
Okay. The Seacoast Century Weekend Bicycle Event, that's going up Route 1A, in case people want to know where this is going to be located, because we have had a few problems with events like that, but that should be fine. It's going all the way up the coast on 1A. The poll petitions for Unitil, Drakeside Road and Toll Farm Road, Fred, is that in conjunction with the new builds that are being proposed over there, or are these replacements, do we know?
They are in conjunction with the new builds that are being proposed over there. They're also an extension of the line.
Okay. Do you see any problems with that?
Well, we had Public Works check it out. They say it's fine. It's in proper position.
Okay. And then if you go back to the Galley Hatch, number one, I don't have a problem with the outdoor service of alcohol, but when I read the letter from John, the deck will offer relaxed seating areas with table service. The deck will also offer a fire pit for a unique dining and lounge experience. I guess that will be unique. Has that been run by the fire department?
It's...
Well, that sounded a little scary when I read it.
It's on the building permit, and the fire department did examine it, so...
Okay.
And they will have to follow the fire regulations in its use.
Eek.
Is there a motion?
We are all set with the motion. I just had questions.
We have them in the second.
Yeah.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Moving on to the approval of minutes, July 13, 2015.
I will so move.
Second.
All those in favor?
Yeah, give me a second to find my minutes because I had one that I turned down here. On page 8 of 9, new business bid waiver purchasing policy, passenger bus. It doesn't say recreation department in there anywhere. I really think it should. It's nice to buy a bus, but I do think it should have said recreation department. Oh, wait a minute. The Parks and Recreation. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I didn't read the whole thing. It does. Ignore me.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Good.
Appointments. Number one, we have Ann Kaiser, Mosquito Control Commission. Please join us at the table. How are you tonight, Ann?
All right. The reason I'm here is we've come to the end of our 3-year contract. And 3 years ago, I came to the board and said, every year we have to send out the request for proposals, and we only get 2 responses ever, and we're still going with the same individual. And Mr. Bean was gracious enough to suggest that we go for a 3-year contract. And so we set up a RFP for both a 1-year and a 3-year. And we went with the 3-year, which was level funded, which makes it a lot easier when you're dealing with default budgets. If you have the same figure for 3 years, you don't have to worry about what happens. So that's my whole purpose in coming here tonight.
Good. I'll be happy to so move, Mr. Chairman, that we grant the request of the Mosquito Control Commission. You're talking about Dragon possibly being the... Yeah.
Yes, prepared. I've just... the last list of qualified commercial applicators that I received from the Department of Agriculture was dated 2009. So I did call them today, and they're going to send me an updated list. So if there are any more that do municipal spraying and mosquito abatement, I will find out.
What's the time frame for the bids, Ann?
For what?
When are you putting the bids out?
Hopefully by mid-September.
Oh, good. Okay.
They have any applicator. This is their height of their busy season. So, mm-hmm. You know, we'd like to get them in sooner. It helps out the planning for budgets. But we have to give them some consideration also.
Good.
So we...
I made a motion to approve.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor... Unanimous.
That was a
Thank you, Ann.
Hard night, Ann.
And incidentally, if anybody goes down to the transfer station and you see all those swallows flying around, they are eating greenheads and mosquitoes. So,
excellent.
We thank Mr. Weber for producing all of the swallow houses that you've seen on the marsh.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. So be nice to the birds.
Yes.
Dave does a good job with those.
Yes, he does.
Next, we have Chief Sawyer of the Police Department. Deputy Chief Hobbs with him this evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good
The first item we have tonight to discuss is a donation or a partnership with the Hampton Beach Area Commission. I was going to ask Mr. Nine if he could step up and explain a grant that they received, that we're going to try to do something new with staffing certain crosswalks at peak traffic times to try to alleviate some of the congestion we're experiencing. So I'm going to let John explain the grant, and then I'll explain what the plan is.
Good evening. For the record, John Nyan, chairman of the Hampton Beach Area Commission. As you all probably know, that we are right now in the middle of a grant with the Department of Transportation at the federal level. And as the first phase of that grant is conducting a study on all transportation issues related to the Hampton Beach Master Plan. In that effort, I have been talking with a number of business owners along Ocean Boulevard and private residents, and also with the chief, with regard to two areas of the master plan study and the transportation grant that has to do with both traffic flow and traffic safety, pedestrian safety on Ocean Boulevard. And we were thinking that, gee, it would be appropriate right now at the grant time for us to conduct a study, a pilot project, to where we could look at the flow of pedestrians down at the beach, especially in the heart of Ocean Boulevard, around the casino and a block up and a block south. We then further talked with the business owners, asking what their thoughts would be if we had a little bit more police control of people walking across each side of Ocean Boulevard. And rather than just having individuals walk anywhere across the street, that we would somewhat corral them, if you will, to crosswalks. And we felt that if we could control that, one, we could have a group of individuals crossing at the same time rather than one and two automatically stopping traffic for the one or two individuals. And then if we were able to do that with the help of the police department, utilizing their workforce, we could increase the traffic flow up Ocean Boulevard and get that traffic jam hopefully a little bit less on certain days and nights. We talked to the chief, knowing that the police budget, especially in the summertime, is hurting. We have a fund under Hampton Beach Area Commission. It's a fund that we have not tied in with the transportation grant, but it's our fund. And last week, we had a special meeting of the Beach Commission, and it was voted unanimously to donate $4,000 towards the cost of the police details down at the at the beach, covering from August 5th, which is a Wednesday, through August 30th, which is a Sunday. And I'll let the chief go from there.
Based on the conversations I had with John, we formulated a plan that we'd use approximately 12 hours of Hampton Department personnel assigned to four crosswalks that we feel are critical. It's the area of G Street north of D Street. There are four crosswalks, three of them being right in front of the casino facility going across to the stage and then down to G Street. We have seen with our use of the crowd control fencing through the 4th of July, we got a lot of good compliments on how that helped expedite the traffic moving through, because it forced the pedestrians to channel to the crosswalk areas. We want to take that a step further by putting an officer at the crosswalk to control those times people actually cross the road, as opposed to you see it, you experience it when you get down there, where two people walk across, one car goes. Then three or four more people come into the crosswalk, and then one more car goes. And under New Hampshire statute, a vehicle must yield the right-of-way to a pedestrian in a crosswalk, and vice versa, a pedestrian must yield the right-of-way to a vehicle if he's not using a crosswalk, which causes a lot of the backup out there in that particular area. That's what our belief is. So I think this is a good project for us to try to address that issue moving forward. On these good weekends, I do intend on deploying the crowd control fence that we have in our inventory. It's not the amount that we had for the 4th of July. Obviously, we had borrowed a lot of that from the city of Lawrence. They were kind enough to donate it for our holiday.
If I feel or the assessment is that this is working well, I will be coming back to the board either through a warrant article or if there's anything left over in the budget to purchase some more of our own fencing and make it a regular practice to control the traffic. As far as the amount of money, I just used a basic average rate of pay for a part-time officer of $19 an hour. It would primarily would be part-time officers there, and then I would look at if we needed to augment based on those deployments, I would use my own funds to bring in extra folks if I needed to.
Questions for the chief? Mr. Bridle.
Yeah, is this also, I think it's a great idea. We used to have G Street, D Street guy, Ash Claw guy. It always kept the people moving. But the other benefit you get out of that, too, is you can also clean out G Street or clean out D Street if you have to for emergency.
Exactly. Correct? When John and I talked, they go, I wanted to hear what his assessment was because it's nice to hear what people from a different perspective talk about. And he went to the true critical streets we teach our folks. You have to keep G Street open. You have to keep D Street open because that's our primary ways to get ambulances and fire apparatus up to the top of Ocean Boulevard if we need them. So they'll be serving a dual purpose. They'll be dealing with the pedestrian traffic, but they'll also be there to manage those issues. So I think that'll be a great benefit.
I think
also.
It's a good idea. We used to have, years ago, we used to have G Street guy or D Street guy, and it always worked well. And I know with, as our numbers have dwindled and to be able to fill those positions been tough, but I commend
you. And on a numbers issue, just to let you know, by the end of the first week of August, we will be down to 28 working specials. We just got two folks let us know that they're taking full-time positions elsewhere. It's just the nature of what we have.
Good for them, bad for us.
Exactly.
But I commend the area commission for stepping forward with this. I think it'll give us some good information as we move down the road.
I agree.
Thank you.
Mrs. Wolseley.
This puts me in mind of one of Fred's favorite sayings about herding cats. Some of us, Mr. Bridle, I dare say, recall when there was a uniformed officer at the head of just about every lettered street when you stood there and looked down the beach. Those were the good old days. Very kind of the HBAC to make the donation, and certainly worthwhile and a much smarter way of keeping things moving down there. So I commend you on your proactive stuff, and thank you, John, for HBAC. It's a smart and timely donation, I think, for a good purpose. Good.
Mr. Bean.
Negative, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Chief. Thank you, Deputy.
Hello. Mr. Waddell. John wanted to say something.
No, but I yield to Mr.
Thank
Selectman.
Thank you. I think it's a great idea. I think over the 4th, you know, when you had that fencing there, I mean, that was really good because it really did funnel people and it made it much more specific where the pedestrians should be and where the cars should be. So I thought that worked nicely. And it's a shame you got to herd people onto the crosswalks, but you have to.
I think it's a safer way to do it. We're even exploring. We started with a fence about 4 years ago, and it was met with some resistance, and understandably, it's a change. But I think the business community has really taken a hard look at it. I think it's actually beneficial. It keeps them closer to those areas where they're doing their business. And we're even exploring. They have actually countertops that hang off of the fence that we're thinking of purchasing, so there'd be a place for people to put their food and drink if they're purchasing something from a vendor. We've even heard people talk about maybe offering advertisement if the town wanted to do something like that. That's a decision made by a higher pay grade than mine, but there's a lot of options that we could do with that to make it look good and with the improvements we're making down there.
That's great, and thank you to the Beach Commission for stepping up. I think that's a good
idea.
Did
you want to say something?
Money.
Yeah, just in kind of closure, at the end of the pilot project, we will be prepared to sit down with public safety and the folks that are working with us at DOT to really kind of do an assessment, because I think this could be a very important change or recommendation that we might want to make within the beach master plan as part of the whole transportation segment. So,
Mrs. Wolseley.
Just before Mr. Nyan leaves, you were kind enough to host the get-together on the master plan with the state, et cetera, and Mr. Griffin and I were both there. What's happened to the list of, wish list or request lists? Or what happened to that? Where are you guys going with that? Do we get some results? Or
yes, by the end of summer, early September, we'll be reconvening that group and anybody else that would like to participate.
Excellent.
to talk about what people have said. For those of you that are Facebookers, you will see the Hampton Beach transportation plan on Facebook, and it's amazing what comments and recommendations we're getting. I would probably say 90% are good recommendations, comments. Others, as we all know, everybody has a negative, but for the most part, we've been getting some good recommendations and ideas from the general public. So
I'll look forward to that.
Okay.
Good.
Yeah, one reason why I was there is because I'm on the Hampton Beach Area Commission, and I would like to say that John does a wonderful job, and we owe him a great deal of thanks for the amount of time that he puts in as the chairman of the Hampton Beach Area Commission. Thank you, John.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Do we need a motion for this?
Yes. I need a motion to give me permission to accept the donation and coordinate these efforts through the HBAC.
Rusty makes that motion.
Yep.
Second.
Second by Jim. All those in favor, unanimous. Thank you.
Thank
would you,
you
like to continue?
We have another item, but if we could, just real quickly, item number four was Mr. Flurry Bernie's Beach Bar. My understanding is I had a conversation with his attorney, Mr. Morris, this morning that I don't know if he withdrew it from the manager's office or not, but it's highly – he did. So he will not be appearing for that. So I'm beyond the others. I just have item number five with the Seafood Festival if you want me to stay for that.
What happened to the bid?
And then we have the bid. I just want to get those other two items just on the record that whether you wanted me to stay for those.
Okay. Can we do the bid now?
Yeah. Why don't you move on to the bid?
The bid. I gave a memo to the manager regarding the bid. This is the bid regarding the equipment of the new cruisers that we purchased. As you know, we have to outfit those with things such as the decals on the vehicles, the lights, the sirens, the radios, which is an encompassing task. We did receive the three bids. The two lowest bids were Osby Mountain Electronics and Adamson Industries. There was an approximate 3,000 difference in the bids with Osby Mountain coming in at the low bid. But based upon a number of issues, I have recommended that we go to Adamson and we'll be requesting a waiver of the policy. The memo you received from Lieutenant Gidley and Lieutenant Gaitis to me outlines all of those cost savings or expenditures that we would send. Mm-hmm. It's a much more distant facility that we would have to be sending our folks and our equipment up to deal with. A number of items were not addressed in the bid from the Osby Mountain bid that are critical to our operation, particularly if we have something that breaks. We need to know that they're coming to our facility to deal with it or they're in a close proximity. Mm-hmm. 80-something miles away is a difficult situation when we have to send officers out of town to send cruisers up, and it's usually two officers to shuttle those back and forth. So it's a costly endeavor for us to be that far away, and I think those issues would quickly eat up the roughly $3,000 difference between the two vendors.
Mr. Chairman, I'll be happy to move that we approve the request of the Chief of Police to in response to the bids for the police emergency equipment installation, to grant the bid to the most appropriate bidder, not the lowest bidder, the most appropriate bidder being Adamson.
I'll second that.
Okay. Comments, Mr. Bridle.
No, I think it's sometimes it's penny wise and pound foolish to take the cheapest bid, and just by that alone, the mileage and the time of sending two vehicles up there, because you're going to have to send two up to pick one up, the wear and tear and everything else, I think the cost savings is going to far outweigh what we're going to spend. So I have no problem with this.
Mrs. Woolsey.
That's fine. I made the motion.
Okay. Mr. Bean.
Negative, sir.
I'm happy.
And Mr. Waddell.
Have you dealt with the OSP one before? Or
yes, we have. They do. And this is no reflection on the work they do. They do outstanding work, as does Adamson. All three bidders. Outstanding work. There's no issue there. It's just whether they suit what suits our needs best. Mm-hmm. And again, I agree with Mr. Bridle. The lowest number isn't always truly the lowest number. I think what we would wind up spending shuttling vehicles back and forth and their ability to respond to something at our headquarters to deal with is much more cost efficient for the department to utilize the one that's 21 miles as opposed to over 80 miles.
Mm-hmm. All those in favor? Unanimous.
And I have a quick question for the chief, if you can. Do we have the traffic enforcement people yet?
We have the supervisor. He's been out, Jim Mills, but it's one of these things. We have a very specific process we have to utilize. He is a past employee with us and a volunteer, so he was easily put to work.
Yeah.
The other folks have to do things like the background check because they're going to have access to the police facility, so it takes a little bit of time to get that done.
Okay. Other questions for the chief? Mr. Waddell.
Totally off subject, but the last time you were here, and just briefly, very quickly, we talked about the heroin problems.
Yes.
And I read in the paper all the time, you know, problems with the state drugs are and stuff. I mean, do you find that you have good communication with them? Are they helping Hampton to deal with this? Or is this
You're going to force me to be blunt, but I guess that's never been a problem for me. I couldn't tell you who the drug czar was.
Okay.
Never heard from him, never met him, never been to a meeting with him.
Oh.
And that's as far as I'm going to go with that.
Okay.
If that explains where we are with
it. Yeah, no, that does explain it. Yeah, and I think it's terrible because we're dealing with such a problem statewide. And I know you guys are being proactive and stuff.
I will assure you that we work well with our federal, state law enforcement partners, the county. Everybody's trying to do what they can. It's not a local issue. It's a regional issue.
Yep.
But as far as who this individual, I've been seeing these headlines, and quite honestly, I scratched my head and said, gee, wow, we'll get a drug czar. It would be nice to meet him and find out what the game plan is. To this point, it hasn't happened, and I'm hopeful that he has a great one. But right now, I don't know what the plan is.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Bridle?
All set.
Mr. Bean?
Negative, sir.
One more quick one. Sorry about that. Thank you for the amendments to the no parking areas. What about Boar's Head? I mean, that's what started this whole thing, was complaints to me from Boar's Head residents.
And again, that meeting was a while ago, but my recollection of the issues on Boar Heads to me was more of a political issue than a safety issue. The political issue is there's a number of folks that want things posted in a different manner. And as we did some of the research, one of the things we discovered that there are certain rights of ways on some of the properties times many years ago, there were right-of-ways for fishermen up there to get down there.
Right.
I heard some people highlight about the surfers.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is the right-of-ways that existed, you wouldn't know where they are because they've, like a lot of areas in town, we've been dealing with down on the North Shore, people have kind of encroached out into the rights-of-ways and kind of made them their own.
Yeah.
We were dealing with an issue today on that very matter.
Yeah.
Up on Boar's Head, I think it was more of an issue of the traffic and the issues of people, what they wanted up in their neighborhood, as opposed to any public safety issues that we had.
Yeah.
The current postings are accurate as to what the current town ordinances are, as far as I can see. And I haven't experienced any issues where I would go up there. My primary concern as the chief of police is if I need to get fire apparatus or ambulances down there, that we can accomplish that.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as I can see, that is workable up on Boar's Head at this time.
But I do appreciate the adjustments because you're fine-tuning. Are we voting on this tonight, Mr. Manager?
Mr. Bridle.
Okay.
Well, while we're on Boar's Head, I had a suggestion from a property owner up there. He wasn't concerned too much about the parking, but as you go up Dumas Ave and then you take the right to make the loop, the trees there and the bushes come right out to the street.
Right on the corner.
And he's had an issue with the number of people that walk Boar's Head. They use it as Heartbreak Hill for their walk down the boulevard and up and around. And he asked about the speed up there. And I was talking with the town manager and see if we might be able to post that corner as 20 miles an hour. A yellow sign. The yellow caution sign. Just so it gets people aware, because coming around that corner, they see...
Yeah.
All of a sudden, these people, they don't see them.
Yep.
So if we could post that at 20 miles an hour, which might help some of the...
Good.
No, I would support that. I mean, it is one of those areas where you come up there, and I think a lot of times people turn up, they don't realize that you're on that intersection pretty quick, and you're only supposed to go to the right. And we've had people going up the other side there by the old restaurant there that's all condos now. And they just go the wrong way, and they've gone the wrong way before they know it.
Right.
Posting some speed, some signs
just
there.
Just to make people aware, the people that walk up there, because there are no sidewalks, and so they're walking in the streets. And he wasn't complaining about the parking. He was just complaining about the speed of the vehicles that were up in there. So that was all.
Good.
No, I would have no objection to that at all.
Thanks.
Okay. Did you have anything else that you wanted to bring up this
evening? I didn't know if you wanted me to stand by for the Seafood Festival Committee meeting, so I'll stand by in the back if you have any questions.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Next, we have Norm Silberdick and the trustees of the Trust Fund. Please join us at the table.
John?
Yeah, come on up. How are you this evening?
I'm well, and you?
Fine, thank you.
I'd like to introduce...
David.
David.
Just pull a chair up.
Yeah, John, pull a chair up. I'd like to introduce fellow trustees who you probably may or may not have met. Bill, Steve, would you like to...
It's good so people in town get to know who their trustees are, too, which
yeah,
is...
We're missing one trustee. He's MIA.
Whoops. I didn't realize there's so many chairs.
Hey, good.
I'm John Sovich.
Steve Felzon.
Well, introduce yourself. Introduce yourself.
I'm Bill Hartley. Okay. I'm vice chairman of the board.
David?
David Mays with Mackinson & Company.
Steve Stokes with Mackinson & Company.
And Norm Silberdick. Good evening.
Good evening.
I know you had invited us on the 2 weeks ago on the 13th. Our materials were in the process of being prepared for our meeting on the 20th, which we in turn invited you to attend. And Jim and Mary Louise showed up at the meeting. And the way we conduct our meetings is a free interaction with the board while we're making motions, and anybody can participate. We also had Representative Tim Jones from the Budget Committee there as well. So, and you had requested four reports, and we had provided those reports to Christy for distribution to you from your meeting on the 13th. And as of today, the fund is still $18 million plus. Our cost is $17 million plus, and we have about $900,000 unrealized gain in the portfolio, and we are generating approximately $700,000 income to the town. The portfolio is 60% in primarily fixed incomes, and a little less than 40%, or maybe it's a little more than in equities right now. But David can give you more details on that. And one of the things that came out of our desire to work with the town to provide whatever information that you would like is that a couple of the reports that you requested, we addressed the privacy and confidentiality of the information. We publish our MS-9 quarterly on our website, and if the town, some of the reports that we're presenting to you can publish on the town website if you'd like, or people can link in through the town to our website. And a couple of reports, because of privacy and potential security, we would ask that they not be published on the website. We're always available to meet with any citizen in the community who would like to get information on the specifics of our portfolio. All they need to do is contact a board member, and we will contact David to arrange that. But so far, in the 7 or 8 years I've been on the board, that's never happened.
Would you like to open, Mr. Bean?
Sure. Thanks for coming in, gentlemen. Thanks for your service to the town. Appreciate it very much. And just going forward on that, the Board of Selectmen are charged under statute, under Chapter 41, to manage the prudential affairs of the town. The $18 million that you talk about represents 70% of an annual operating budget. It's a significant amount of money. And it's one that we think that the board, at least I think, needs to accept responsibility in line with state law as it relates to trust funds under Chapter 31. And received the email traffic on confidentiality. And I think that with that amount of money, with the turbulence in the stock market, that it's important that we have these types of meetings and that we have more open communication. I don't think the website that you provide information on is particularly current or helpful. From your website in 2008, there was $15.2 million. And then from your website on 9/30/2011, it's at $14.8 million. So exclusive of distributions for over 3 years, the town has lost money. It's important to consolidate gains. It's important to have a discussion about leaving money on the table or taking money off the table, especially as volatile as this worldwide economy is. You have to search on your website for data up until the production on the website of the data that was requested. There really was no current information in granularity and in terms of detail, and we're getting there. So thank you for that. Mr. Mackinson produced the data back in 2014 without, to me directly, it was forwarded to the board without any concerns of confidentiality or security risk. I have those emails. That was Monday, August 11th of 2014. He was, as I understand it, still president of that company. Highfield, here's the information that is responsive to your questions at the galley hedge this morning. There's no addressing any of the concerns that were addressed in his email to town council and the town manager this week. So,
are you talking apples?
Well, let me just finish. Let me just finish, please. Okay. So, going along with that, in your website, and I went to your website to specifically address those issues. I went to the advanced trustee training on the Mackinson website, and the Attorney General has provided that PowerPoint slide, and that is the charitable trust unit, and it specifically addressed the right to know and information request. Government should be open, accessible, and accountable. To that end, public's rights to access governmental proceedings and records should not be unreasonably restricted. It talks about 91A. We all know about that. And it talks about agency and public body records are subject to disclosure. And I don't think that your minutes on the website meet the standard of what's going on with that amount of money. Public has a right, and this again is from the Mackinson website. Public has a right to inspect and copy all non-exempt government records in the custody control of a public body or agency. If they're not immediately available, they'll be made available later. Any information created, accepted, or obtained on behalf of a public body are subject to that inspection. And it's written, oral, visual, electronic. And this is from the Attorney General's office. And that's the standard in the compliance with the law that the Board of Selectmen in governing the prudential affairs of this town, almost $20 million, is interested in, because we stand this watch and it's important. And we've lost millions of dollars before in this turbulent market. And again, thank you for your service in providing your service to this effort. These documents that are must be made available are documents stored in the computer, email, voicemail, instant messages, and digital photos. Electronic records must remain accessible for the same retention or archival periods as their paper counterparts. Concerning Mr. Mackinson's email to the town manager, this most recently, the Attorney General, again from the Mackinson website, talks about redaction. Your website at Mackinson speaks to your concentration or your practice concentration, perhaps, in trustee of the trust funds. You put it out there that you enforce and follow best practices, that you ensure compliance with state laws, that you ensure an investment policy that meets RSA requirements, that you provide secure online account access to those portfolios. Specifically, the Attorney General's office, and again from the Mackinson website, talks about redaction. Your firm is in the business of working with nonprofits and government agencies, and I speak as one member of the Board of Selectmen. It's up to you and your responsibility when you're providing this information to the governing body to redact, as the Attorney General has instructed your firm to do so, to provide information. And any liability that Mr. Mackinson would have talked about lies with your firm, because you solicited the business, you conduct the business, and it's your liability to conform with the Attorney General and to redact any confidential information. We hope we could have an agreement on that. Your website, as we get back to the Board of Trustees, your minutes I don't find especially helpful. I'll start off with your frequently asked questions. There's been conversations about accessing the $18 million or a portion of that for our own town use. On your question and frequently asked questions, can the town borrow money from the real estate fund? And you put yes, however, it makes little sense to borrow from the real estate. I don't think that's very objective. I think that's an opinion. And then you further state on your website, on August 23rd, 2010, which as we go into the next fiscal year, that'll be 6 years old, the Board of Selectmen affirmed there is no benefit to the town in borrowing money from the real estate fund. I would suggest that that needs to come up to a more contemporary speed in terms of information. Your reports. You've got text and data from the annual town reports on your website. You've got to go to the town report and then go to your report within that, several hundred pages, and find that. I don't find that very effective. I don't find it informative in the standard of this economy that exists today. I don't find that it meets the spirit or the standard of state law. Regarding the actual management information's in the Capital Reserve Fund. You've got several funds in there. The Town Roads Capital Reserve Fund, it's got a 2014 year-end balance of $610,000. That needs to be made more knowledgeable to the public, especially as we do capital improvements, especially as we look towards budgets. And of course, that income distribution is directed by the town meeting and warrant articles, not by the selectmen, by the people of the town of Hampton. You've got the Department of Public Works Equipment Capital Reserve Fund as directed by town meeting and warrant articles. You've got the Compensated Leave Trust Fund. The auditor for the town of Hampton has identified a seven-figure shortfall in that amount. Your 2014 year-end balance from the website today indicates a principal of $279,900. As the selectmen move forward, we'll be looking to enhance our audit performance and actually identifying the cost of doing business with employees in this town, because that trust fund balance is about $800,000 short of the actual exposure, and that was declared by our auditors at the last audit, and it's been a perennial problem. In terms of the evaluation, I'll forward to you through the chairman about 15 different questions specifically. I won't bore the public nor take up time with the board. It'll be about the risk tolerance section in the investment policy. It'll be about the investment strategy section, the asset allocation section, the frequency of review section, overall constraints, the mutual funds, and an overall general synopsis of how you've changed your way of doing business from when there were exposures as recently as 2009 and 2011, where exclusive of distributions, the town of Hampton lost millions of dollars in that trust fund. And again, the information that has come back through
you folks today, exclusive of distributions, or as you say on your website with Mackinson Company. Pardon me, withdrawals for the last 3 months, 03/31/2015 to 6/30/2015, which in my mind is a 3 month period. We've lost $170,000 this quarter, and that's from the Mackinson Company. So we just went through labor negotiations with the fire department. I think I haven't read it, but I think you put an article in paper that the selectmen were incorrect in asserting that. That amount of money would perhaps substantially, if not completely, fund the firemen's pay raise that you said the selectmen were incorrect in doing. So I wanted to bring that to the fore. We comply with state law. We handle the prudential affairs. And if anybody on this board or in this town thinks that $18 million is not prudential, then I guess I'm in the wrong business. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Would you like to respond?
Yeah, well, first of all, I would like to make an opening remark that we're always willing to provide information to the selectmen as requested. We don't recommend end runs, such as what occurred where Mr. Bean feels he can meet somebody at a coffee shop or send an email to David Mays and ask for information. We'd like all that coming through the office of the chair and, in my absence, the vice chair. And we'll be happy to provide you with information since you're very much involved with protocol. I have here the fund balance is going back to 2008 to 2015. I'd like to share these with you because there are periods where there are ups and downs. I provide these to the selectmen. In 2010, we replaced the investment advisor we had at the end of 2010 with Mackinson and Company, and then we put it out for bid in 2011. Mackinson and Company won the bid. And we went from a strategy of direct investment in equities where we did lose millions of dollars, and we took a much more prudent approach, and we invested with mutual funds. We've invested both in the equities and fixed incomes. And further, because this is 100-year money, the way we view it, we've invested directly into investment-grade fixed income securities, which will hold to maturity. Our average hold period will be about 11 years, but there'll be no risk of a principal. And as a result, the town can look forward to getting steady income. And we have taken a strategy that we don't have anything more than 5% in any one particular investment. We're constantly reevaluating the performance of the investment. The investment advisor has the free rein to make changes and has done so. The board has recommended to the investment advisor to make direct investments in fixed securities, and we now have $2.5 million in fixed investments, direct investments, specifically bonds. And we're generating, the fact that the market went down, the markets are what the markets are, and they will always be like that. And if you look at the schedule, there were many periods where there was losses. This is not the first time it's happened, and then it comes back. And over the long haul, the equity market has risen, and I don't see any reason that won't happen again. And we've lived through flash, as Steve, you're putting it out, flash markets.
We had flash between 1987, October of 1987, the New York Stock Exchange closed at 1738. The NASDAQ closed at 360, and the S&P closed at 224. Markets closed today at 17. New York closed at 17440. NASDAQ closed at 5039, and the S&P closed at 2067. I mean, between those periods, you had Black Monday, you had the tech bubble, you had the 2011 attacks, and you had the financial crisis of 2007 to 2008. I mean, markets go up and markets go down. I mean, it's just the nature of the business. The funds are set up for long-term investing. and long-term benefits to the town. Thank you.
Why don't we let any of the other gentlemen that would like to say something?
John?
The town hasn't lost any money over the 8 years that you've been invested. You only lose money if you sell. And we haven't sold any of those funds.
I think they're fine, Mrs. Wilson.
Well, but the sound quality is not good at home.
And that's not up to you to handle it.
They need to be heard.
I think they're fine.
I've got it.
Thank you, Mrs. Wilson.
That's good. But the assertion that the town has lost millions of dollars is incorrect. In the last 7 years, there's been $4,500,000 turned over to the town at a rate of $642,000 a year. At the same time, the market value of the portfolio has gone up almost $3 million. So the assertion that the town has lost money is incorrect, and the assertion that you can take some of that money and buy something else with it is also incorrect. It's trust fund money. It's been run according to the RSAs. We've all been trained by the state of New Hampshire to be trustees, have gone to that training, and we have complied with all their regulations. So, I mean, I take that as an affront to say to this group that you've lost money for the town.
Thank you. And the other gentleman, please join us and
Bill?
Say something if you'd like to.
Do I have to have that close
yes.
to me?
You're fine. I'm sure you're fine.
You're not hearing him at home.
I'd like to say why I am a trustee of trust funds. When I first moved to the town, I didn't pay any attention to trust funds. But Mr. Mackinson educated me, and I started to pay attention, and I found out that for 20 years after the fund was established, and it was established specifically by the sale of property down at the beach, and it was meant to be a permanent fund for the use of the town. And I look upon that as being a treasure for the town. Not many other towns have anything like that. And whoever set that up and said you cannot spend the principal, but all the income goes to the town to defray taxes, that was a brilliant setup. And we honor that today. The for 20 years, it was about $16 million, $15 or $16 million. It never grew. And the reason it never grew is because they never invested any of the money to take care of inflation. And during that 20-year period, the inflation went up a huge amount. And if it earned any income, the income was turned over to the town, and so the fund stayed the same. And so when I was educated to this fact, I decided to run. And unfortunately, I ran against Vic Lassad. And there was no chance I was going to beat Vic Lassad. But in the same year, we put a warrant article in saying, let's increase the board from 3 to 5. And the purpose of that was to get some new blood on the board and hopefully do something about that lack of preparedness for inflation. And that passed, and we now have 5 members of the board. And I ran later on, was elected to the board. Now, when the board decided to do something about inflation, the only place you do that is through equities. And they decided that 60-40 was a good split. 60 in the things they'd been invested in for years, fixed income, and 40% in equities, which as time goes on, it will go up over time and take care of that inflation shortfall. Sure. And unfortunately, the day that we changed it over was the day just before we had the market crash. And so we lost $1.5 million or $2 million over a period of a year or so. And in hindsight, it would have been better for us to dollar cost average that change from 100% fixed income to 60% fixed income and 40% equities. But we didn't do that. And so we did lose that. And that put it down $1.5 million to $2 million. And what and behold, today we have $18 million there, not $16 million. So it all came back. And because this is a permanent fund set up for the benefit of the town to throw off income, then this is, we look upon this as permanent money. In other words, it's not a piggy bank for the town to take money out whenever they want, to spend on whatever they want, and destroy it. One of the advantages this fund has to the town is it goes on the balance sheet of the town when they go out to borrow money. So on the balance sheet of the town, they have $18 million. So when they go out to borrow some money to build a fire station or repair schools or whatever, the borrowers and the lenders look at that and they say, well, they got $18 million there. And it gives us a lower interest rate. If you spend all that money, you're not going to get the $600,000 a year in interest to the town, and you're not going to have that asset on the balance sheet to reduce the cost of your borrowing. So what I'm saying is it's permanent money, not a piggy bank for the town, and you should leave it alone because it's a treasure this town has that not very many other towns have. That's my reason for being a trustee.
And how long have you been a trustee?
About 5 years.
Thank you very much. It pays to have your experience of being on the board to be able to explain it like you just did. Thank you. Did you want to say something, sir?
I don't really have anything to add other than you do have a solid board of trustees with some investment experience, and it's a pleasure working with them.
Thank you.
And we're here to answer any questions about the portfolio.
Thank you. And did you want me? No?
No.
Okay. We'll come to the board now, Mr. Bridle.
Well, like I said, I use somebody and do my own investments for me for the same reason as you want to have some good quality people doing it. It would be nice if we could, I'm not saying not pay it back, but use some of that instead of paying the interest rates, use some of that for some of our bond issues so that we're not paying $200,000, $300,000, $400,000 in interest. Still pay it back to the trust fund. So the trust fund wouldn't lose any of the money because it would be paid back, but would refrain from us from keeping the interest rates. Is there any way to do that?
Well, it's a wash if it happens, because the interest expense that you pay equals the interest income that we get. They offset each other, so it's basically an interest-free loan to the town. And then when we get paid back to principal, we're losing on the basis of inflation, because the time value of money will shrink the value of the money that's paid back. The town's borrowing rate is, I believe, less than what we're earning right now. And it's in the town's best interest, because if you take $5 million or $10 million of that money and you lose $400,000 of income, that's $400,000 less income, and it's a free loan, or you're basically just taking the money, because paying it back won't help the trust. I think that apart from this, I mean, the money goes to the town. If you want it for public works, you can use it to either lower tax base or reallocate it in some manner that you can use those funds for capital improvements or setting up money for additional activities that help the town. But I think it's bad accounting. You wind up having no income coming in, offsetting your interest, and you're really losing the value of what that trust fund represents. In my opinion, bad business decision.
Mm-hmm. Mrs. Wolseley.
Yeah, I certainly agree with the trustees on that. We went from an old-fashioned board of trustees in the three-man boards with gentlemen who wanted to be safe with the money. And there was a little flurry when the new trustees and the expanded board of trustees took over and got into investing, as you said, in the stocks and in the market. So there was a transition there, but it looks like things have certainly stabilized. I think you gentlemen have done an excellent job. I am totally opposed to tapping the principal on the trust fund. And as I have mentioned before, in the 80s, when town leased land was sold, which is where this money came from, individuals were allowed to purchase the town leased land for a third of its value. And that was terrible. We'd have a double fund now if people had been assessed, shall we say, more reasonably for the property that the town sold to them. But this is a great asset for the town. I appreciate the comment that Norman made on having this $18 million asset sitting there to assist us in borrowing and in bonding and making a more favorable presentation as a town to the borrowers when we go looking for help. I'm very, very wary. I don't want to see anything touched on the principal on this.
And Mr. Waddell?
It's good income.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. And I hope nobody feels like it's an affront or anything, that because it's just a discussion. That's my feeling, yeah. That we're just having a discussion and nothing else. And, you know, I went to your meeting. I listened to it. I think you're well diversified. I think you've got a good portfolio. I think you guys are doing a good job. And I agree that it's 100-year money. I understand Phil's concern. I think transparency is the thing that we all got to make sure we have. Everything is transparent, and I think you're trying to achieve that. In today's market, investing in anything is in today's world, not today's market. I mean, we all hope things keep going up, but nobody knows. Yeah. Nobody knows. Anything could happen. But you have been successful in raising it up, and I do agree with the fact that you got to keep up with inflation, and if you have it in something else, you're not going to keep up with inflation. You might feel safer about it, but nothing's happening to it. It's just staying there kind of flat. And so you have to take some risk. And I agree that, you know, I as much as I would love to say, let's borrow from it, I don't think we should. I agree. It's permanent money. It's principal. It should stay there, and it should produce income for us. So, you know, I agree with what you guys are doing right now.
Well, I hope by being present at our meeting and you got the flavor of the interchange between the various parties, and we have investment professionals. This is not a bunch of, I mean, we are caring community representatives. We live in the area. We want to see Hampton do well. We really love Hampton, but we're also our professional people managing money. And as a result of that, we have mandated through discussion and with David and the Mackinson team to have a conservative strategy that's still going to generate a 4% return to the town, which is a very attractive conservative philosophy, and one that we're very proud of. It.
Right. I agree. Thank you for what you do.
And we love revenue.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for coming.
Can I get one just follow up? Yeah, and again, we hear you, sir, and please, as Jim says, no affront. This is just the prudential affair of the town. We are a governing body. You have your statutory responsibilities in accordance with state law. This gentleman says we didn't lose money on your own board. This gentleman said you did lose $2 million just now. The numbers I am using are just off of your website. And the difference between younger people looking and listening to this in Black Monday is Wall Street has changed and where our money swims. And just real quickly, and I think this is important, is the Glass-Steagall Act was repealed and investment banks had to be bailed out by my grandchildren and everyone's grandchildren in this room. And just where our money is swimming, I just wanted to go over 10 top bank finds from 2010 to 2013. And again, these are the professionals, and they handle a lot more money than you do. But this is where our tax money is. $25 billion for Wells Fargo, JP Morgan, Citigroup, Bank of America. They were fined $25 billion for foreclosure processing abuses. And these are professional money men, too. Only they make a lot more money than you folks do and than we do. $9.3 billion for foreclosure abuses. 13 banks, to include Bank of America, Wells Fargo, JP Morgan, and 10 others. $1.9 billion, money laundering, HSBC, 2012. $1.5 billion for manipulating LIBOR rates. $920 million in 2013. For lack of oversight of giant bets by the London Whale. That was with JP Morgan. $550 million for Goldman Sachs for materially misleading and incomplete information in the sale of mortgage-related securities.
$453 million for Barclays for manipulation of interbank lending rates. $410 million electricity market manipulation for JP Morgan Chase. $335 million discrimination against Black and Hispanic borrowers, Bank of America. So times have changed on Wall Street. That's where our money is. We respect you. You're honest people. You're competent people. You're professional people. We are just doing our prudential affairs. The street has changed. Where our money swims has changed. And if we weren't standing our watch and doing this type of research and raising this, if the market does crash again and the government can't go to the well and bail out Wall Street with my grandchildren's money, then woe on me and anyone that sits on this board. And I thank you for your integrity and for showing up in your service to the town. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I just want to make a point regarding the comments you made. Of course, those are the result of the largesse of the banking, lack of controls in the banking community. And in that period of time, we had an investment advisor who was making investments and was very strong in the financial securities industry, and we lost a lot of money on some of those names. And that was the catalyst for replacing that investment advisor and putting it out for bid. And we changed our strategy from that kind of investing to a much more hedged bet with the mutual funds that we have purchased, and we are not heavily betting on Banks of America or Wells Fargo or HSBC. They may be buried in a portion of a portfolio someplace, but they're not where we're putting our money. And we, I think, have taken with this board and a much more conservative view to protect the town's money and treat it like granny's money so it's not going to be lost. And I agree. Those kind of situations for which there's no result, nothing has helped the citizens who suffered from all these things, but we're seeing time is healing wounds. We just hope it doesn't repeat itself.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
We are free to meet with you anytime you want. If you want to have a visit with us or come to our meetings, you're always welcome to come and participate in them. We are trying to be open. We'll always provide information to you that you request. So. That's all I can tell you.
Now, Norm, how long have you been on the board?
I think I've been there. I'm trying to remember. I ran on a campaign to get rid of all the scoundrels. I think it's 2008. I've been there 7 years.
Yeah. And you?
Five.
And you're the new person?
He's Mackinson.
With Mackinson. Okay. Well, great. We appreciate it. Thank you for coming in. And
thank you for your information.
It gives the public a lot of
right.
chance to see what's happening, and we appreciate that you came in tonight.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you,
John.
Thank you. Thanks, John.
Next, we have Jude David, the Hampton Chamber of Commerce Seafood Festival Activities. And Doc Noel.
A lot of conversation is in $18 million.
Wish.
A few zeros less than that. Thanks for having us. Hard to believe 26 years. Seafood Festival, we all know some of us have been around since it first started. I'm a one-day event that poured rain, if you were around, remember that. It's how time flies when we're having fun. I think you all know Jude David. Jude's been doing the general chairmanship of the Seafood Festival for the last 14 years, I believe. I'm pretty good guess. So we thank you for your time, and I'll let Jude handle the logistics of the meeting regarding Seafood Festival for 2015. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you for having us here this evening. I'll go through the fluff part for the people watching at home, just wondering, you know, what our festivities are, and then we can get down to some other details as well. So the 26th annual Hampton Beach Seafood Festival is scheduled for September 11th through the 13th this year. It's always the weekend after Labor Day. Any information that I go over can be found on our website, which is hamptonbeachseafoodfestival.com. We have a spectacular event planned. Once again, we were named one of the top 100 events in North America by the American Bus Association. And we are really a national recognized festival. It's amazing the magazines and the publicity that we get really nationwide. We have 60 of the top restaurants in the Seacoast area, the greater Seacoast area, serving an abundance of mouth-watering seafood delicacies, 8 arts and craft vendors doing the locally made products, hundreds of Ocean Boulevard merchants offering the end-of-season sales, Kiddyland, we have ongoing entertainment for the kids and games, face painting, etc. And the Wicked Bites Culinary Chef Demonstrations, where you can watch, sample, and learn from some of the best chefs in the area. We also have continuous entertainment on 2 stages with 15 bands and orchestras, 3 main events planned. The first one, the lobster roll eating competition. If you haven't seen that, it is sick. It's a sight, and it's really, it's become one of the biggest events inside the festival. It's a sea of people by the by the seashell stage. They go back as far as the you can see in the
urchin. It shocked me for that crowd for that, really did.
It's
how
amazing.
Many do you eat, Doc? I wouldn't be able to have one for one for that quick.
So that's Saturday at 2, and then we have fireworks Saturday night at 8:15, which is September 12th. And then on Sunday, we have Skydive New England back doing that thrilling skydiving demo onto ocean. Actually, onto the beach, not Ocean Boulevard. That would be scary. So it takes over 600 volunteers to put on this event. We're always looking for volunteers. If you want to volunteer, we give you a free T-shirt, free admission into the event, and an incredible after party at the Ashworth by the Sea. And it's really just a great way to, you know, take pride in volunteering, showing off Hampton Beach, and also fun-filled weekend in which you can meet new friends and have a great time. If you want to register as a volunteer, you can go to our website, and everything's on there as far as, you know, the positions that are still open, etc. First Student offers the free shuttle and parking as usual. They are incredible. They mainly donate the 20 buses. We have 13 different satellite lots. If it were not for First Student, we could not even put on this event because the traffic, it would be horrific. So we appreciate that. And the different locations are listed on our website as well. Admissions, $5 on Friday and Sunday, and then $8 on Saturday. And then children under 12 are free. It's really the best deal for a festival of everything that we have to offer, the free parking, shuttle, entertainment, fireworks, the Kiddyland culinary demos, etc. You know, I know what other festivals are charging, and this is the best deal in town for all that we have. Last year, we decided to do, our board of directors wanted to really see how much of an economic impact we have on the community. So we hired the experts. We hired IFEA, International Festival Event Association. They are really the experts in festivals across the world. We hired them. We flew them up here. They came with their volunteers, and they surveyed all weekend long. And they surveyed hundreds and hundreds of attendees, probably into the thousands. Through that report, the final data reported that we had over 125,000 people that attended the 2014 Seafood Festival. And the total attendance with locals and visitors alike from other states of the Hampton Beach Seafood Festival generated a direct expenditures of just under $6 million. And that's huge. I mean, for a festival to bring that amount of economic impact to a town, to the seacoast, it's amazing. And we have a full detailed report. We're happy to share with you. I'm sure not everyone in the world wants to hear all of our details, but it's amazing when you look at, we have it broken down by, you know, how much they spend at restaurants, how much they spend in hotels, how many stay overnight, where they're coming from. It's a 30-page 10-page report, and it's amazing to actually have all this information that we can share and show people, you know, what could we do for the community and the businesses that we serve.
I think a lot of the figures, they really surprised us in terms of where people came from and how many, and excuse me, the biggest one was, I found, was a repeat. The amount of repeat people to come, and they would the best advertising was the people themselves telling others, especially with all the new development that's happened at the state level with the new construction and so forth. But anyway, go ahead.
That's a very valid point. We actually asked people, like, if they were satisfied, unsatisfied, extremely, very, 0% were not satisfied. And 76% said that they will visit again. 83% said that they have come before, and I don't have the percentage on that one marketing stat, but the majority of the people come by word of mouth. It's not radio advertising, nothing. It's word of mouth, and that's great. That's, you know, to have a customer like that that brags about you, that's one for the books. So, you know, we help put Hampton on the map. The hotels are booked a year in advance. Local business owners will attest that it's the biggest weekend of the season, even above 4th of July. 4th of July, people come with picnic baskets, et cetera. Seafood Fest, we attract a different demographic. Bottom line, everyone knows that. You know, there's different people. And they come, they plan their vacations around it. We also give back to nonprofit organizations, and the town of Hampton benefits greatly from the town parking lots, which are full. They average about, I think it's 20,000. Is that correct, that weekend? I think that's what Fred and I had discussed a while back.
It's more than that.
It's more than 20. So the town generates a lot. Along with all of this, it extends the summer season as well. That's why we made it, you know, the weekend after Labor Day, so that everyone would benefit, our businesses, everyone would benefit from adding a season on, a weekend on. So it's the largest event, but it also comes with the largest budget. And that leads me into, of course, the conversation. We've had many conversations with Chief Sawyer, and, you know, that started directly probably after the last Seafood Festival. So, you know, we understood that details were going to increase. We met with Chief Sawyer again last week. And I just wanted to share some numbers with you and with the community as far as how much our expenses have increased. By taking details off the Seafood Fest. Mainly, the town used to extend the season until after Seafood Festival. Now the town ends it after Labor Day. So how that affects us is, last year we had 14 details and we paid $30,000. This is just police. I'll get into fire. This year, we have to add an estimated 8 to 10. So let's average 9. If you take last year's numbers, then that means $50,000 just in police details for a three-day event. We also just got notification from the fire department, an estimate of their details for this year. So last year we paid $11,885. This year the estimation is $21,280. So just for details with police and fire, we're at $27,000 over last year. The state of New Hampshire, DRED, also increased our fee $4,000. So now we're up over $30,000. And that's just with the town of Hampton, the state of New Hampshire. We're also facing increases in insurance, increases in tents. Everything, every expense we have is going up. We have a board. We have a very active board. I report to a full board, and then we have a sub-board that focuses just on Seafood Festival. We meet often. We've cut everything we can. Unfortunately, we reached out to the Rotary because that was one of our largest expenditures, and we tried to come to an agreement to reduce that, and we couldn't come to an agreement, so we have the Knights of Columbus and the Wounded Warriors who are going to be staffing the gates. We're making really difficult decisions in order to save this festival. And my biggest concern, and it's my job to share this concern with everyone, is that if it rains, the festival won't be back. We only netted, when you take out all the labor and everything, if it rains and we don't get our insurance quote, we won't be back. And we missed that. We almost missed that, last year. We did get rain insurance. Thank goodness we get it every year. We only got 0.02 over what our insurance required. If that 0.02 didn't come when it did, because you have to pick a time frame, we would have been 50 grand in the red this year. So I'm just trying to explain to you, I understand what's happening with the town, and I understand why you're making your decisions. I'm trying to share with everyone, if we have a bad seafood festival, it's really going to jeopardize the event. And I don't know anyone that could help us get out of that red. Last year, our total expenses were $520,926. So if you add in the $30,000 increase from the town and the state, you're up to $550,000, and then we have all the other, added expenses. But really, based on last year, we're going to be in the red. If we don't have good weather, we're going to be in the red. We're looking at ways to increase revenues, decrease expenses, but everything's working against us. So
we don't want to increase the admission to the point that people can't afford to come.
And that ruins, yeah.
And that's we've maintained that for the last several years, as you know. And it's something the board did not want to increase for obvious reasons, but to make it make it affordable.
It's just hard because I understand where you all stand. I understand where Chief Sawyer stands, but I just want you to understand where we stand. Mm-hmm. Because I don't think people really know. I think people just think that we make a lot of money, and we don't tell people enough. We don't share what our expenses are enough. And it's really scary. I don't sleep at night. Trust me. When you have a 3-day event and you're at $550,000, that's huge. And what is the percent that the seafood has in the chamber?
The Seafood Festival event, and I've mentioned this, I believe, in past years, runs 62% of the total operating cost of the Chamber of Commerce for the year, which is a 2.5-day event. It's 62%. It's something that has grown. We all know that. As we just started talking about the 1-day event, mm-hmm. and it has taken hold more and more, but the costs are going up. One of the problems we have, like a lot of businesses, we're maxed out for obvious reasons. Excuse my voice, a cold coming on. We're maxed out for obvious reasons from the amount of room that we have. And you can't go any further, and it is what it is. But the cost, as Jude indicated, the cost across the board have really climbed. Tremendously. Interesting enough, when I first started, I was going to be in this job for a couple of years. When I first started, the tents were 17,600, and last year they were 79,000. That was required by a lot of regulations, the fire departments, and different type of tents, and we had some problems with them. But that's just one of the. Since 9/11, we all know that insurance. Have insurance people here that certainly know have gone up tremendously. Rain insurance went up again another couple of thousand dollars, as you had indicated, this year. So everything, it's expenses across the board.
Okay. Did you have any other points you wanted to bring up before we bring it back to the board?
A couple of things that the normal say routine and requests that we have that we put forth. First of all, the traffic pattern. It's the same plan essentially that it has been for the last 20 years. We work very closely with the Hampton Police Department, the Fire Department, DOT, DPW. As far as shutting down, setup begins on Tuesday. Actually Monday at midnight, and then it goes, we shut down Ocean Boulevard, Ashworth becomes two-way, etc. So mainly we're asking for the same traffic plan that we've had. And requests for the closure of A through H Street for the admission gates which is the same. Nothing has changed there. The request for 8 parking spaces at Church Street, we requested this last year, and I guess it's for the state employees because we take all of their parking. So we take 100% of their parking. They have no place to park. So we've always gotten those passes, and we've always given them to the state. But somehow last year that became a concern that we were giving those to the state. I'm not sure. I don't know, but we need 8 parking spaces because they have none now. We take over their whole, you know, in front of the Park Patrol and the Oceanfront Pavilion, the Chamber parking lot. We also request the town parking lot times. For those days, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, we have people coming early. So if you could open at 8 a.m. and close at 10 p.m., which is what we've done in the past as well, it just helps the town make money, really. Request of the use of message boards for DPW. Again, same thing as usual. We have one message board located on Ocean Boulevard by High Street, or is it?
I think it's High Street.
Across from the old Lupo's. And it says left, yeah. It says left lane buses only, so Winnicott. That the buses
Winnicott.
Can
Winnicott.
Get Winnicott. So at the end of, the end of Winnicott and Ocean Boulevard. And it mainly just gets it so that those buses can have that left lane and they can get people down there and back quickly. And then the other one is on Route 101 west of Landing Road, and it says free parking shuttle service with an arrow pointing left so that we get people off 101 and not have a traffic jam down at Ocean Boulevard. And those are the same requests that we've had for the past, I don't know how many years. And really, you know, I just want to end in just saying, you know, the Seafood Fest, it's really a win-win for everyone. You know, our community, our businesses, the people who come, it's a fun-filled weekend, and we really, you know, we work hard to put on this event for the community, and we just, you know, we just want you guys to kind of understand our point as well as far as, you know, how everything affects us and how it might potentially, at some point, jeopardize the event. And that's my biggest fear.
Okay, Mr. Waddell.
Yeah, I mean, those requests there, I go with, you know, fine. I mean, I support the seafood festival and everything. I mean, it does bring in a lot of money. But one thing I know Phil will bring up, and we have to really think about, a lot of that money goes to rooms and meals, which doesn't come back to
the
town.
No, I understand that.
And that's where you get the conflict between the town and the state, saying, yeah, there's a lot of money coming in, and that's really cool, but we're not getting it back. And if we ask the chief and the deputy chief to provide, you know, extra details, then that's cutting into their budget, which, mm-hmm. again, we have a hard time all summer with that because we don't get the money back from the state. And I got to say, personally, I would much rather see him use his personnel to fight the drug issues we have than to provide details. I mean, in his budget, I mean, I think that's a different thing. But I understand all that, and I'm very, very supportive of it. But I just wish that the town would get more of that money back that's being generated. And I think the businesses, that's great. But the regular things, I support. Yeah.
Mr. Bridle.
No, I feel the same way. Actually, I feel the same way. It's too bad we can't get some more help from the state. And obviously, them going up like $4,000 and the money that they, you ought to send them these figures that you're showing here, what they generate down here. You know, they're obviously bringing it in, but as far as the other things, the signboards, I mean, absolutely. It's just tough with the police chief, with you know, if you look back over the past 10 years, I think we've had 8 or 7 default budgets, and when you don't have that money there, they have to start, as he explained to us tonight, he's down to 28 summer specials now. And years ago, we used to have 50 or 60 of them. And it makes it tough to fill with shifts that we already have. So, but other than that, I mean,
Seafood Festival's always been a wonderful event, and we'll try to help you as best we can, but we've got limitations also.
Yeah, one of the problems is that if it was just people from Hampton that were taking part in the Seafood Festival, it might be a little different. But there's a lot of people making money that come from all other towns, and, you know, it truly is a bigger event than just people here in Hampton. And that's why there seems to be, with some people, the people that live in Hampton are being responsible to pay some of these bills. And that's where there seems to be a difference in the balance. Mrs. Wolseley?
Could I ask Doc, especially since there are new people in the community and so forth on this, the profits that are made, after all the expenses are taken care of, go to the chamber, which is an area chamber. It's not just Hampton, right?
Correct.
And that provides, you said, about 60% of your operating expenses?
No, the total. What I'm saying is of our total operating budget for the Chamber of Commerce.
Right.
Excuse me again.
That's all right.
The total operating budget for the Chamber of Commerce, 62% is Seafood Festival.
Right.
So when you have, like, anybody, for example, you had a business.
Right.
And that was, you know, one of your customers is 60%, mm-hmm. and for whatever reason,
right.
they leave.
Right. Pretty devastating.
I mean, and I happen to know some, having been in the grocery business, some different people, mm-hmm. from major wholesalers, that has happened to, mm-hmm. aside from that. So you have an operation during the entire year. For example, during off-season, you have staff that, quite frankly, you really don't need, mm-hmm. At that time, but you can't let people go and start for somebody every right. every single spring.
Right.
You bring a couple, two or three new people in and say, okay, now we want you to do this or that.
Right.
Blah, 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 blah. So it is, for lack of a better word, spread out okay. over cost, if I'm making yeah. sense to you.
Yeah, that's good. It's so it's not a matter of diverting the revenue to charities or whatever. You're using this for the purposes of the chamber, the area, Seacoast area,
that
chamber, for your operating expenses. Jude mentioned something about 600 volunteers, and I'm sure it does take a lot of volunteers to
correct.
Do this. What about paid staff? How many paid staff?
We have very limited paid staff. Like, out of all the 600 volunteers, I have to have a manager at key locations, so, you know, the two beer tents, you have to have managers. There's literally two paid people in that whole beer tent. The Coke tents both need a manager. Anyone who's handling cash,
yeah.
you can't have a volunteer doing. So the only, like, the paid positions we have are managers.
Mm-hmm.
There's no, like, no one down there that's getting paid except for operations staff. You know, people to set up, people to pick up trash, et cetera. We hire about 24 people to do the operation, set up, tear down, and maintain.
Okay. And that includes your position, the managers that
correct.
You're talking about.
Yeah. And we have year-round staff right. at the chamber.
Okay. Are you still putting out the same constraints this year? Are you recommending to people that they do not bring their dogs? And
yeah. Absolutely.
Yes.
That's it.
They still come with them. But
well, I'm
most,
sure.
Most assuredly we do.
Sometimes in strollers.
They do. I did watch Mayor Walsh today when he was making the announcement on the Olympics being discarded, basically, for the city of Boston. But I do agree with what he said, especially in the context of our police, fire, and public works departments. I don't want the taxpayers of this town paying $1 for what is essentially a private enterprise. So I certainly respect what you do, but I certainly stand behind whatever we need to bill for services for our public employees who are helping you out in this endeavor.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think you're doing one heck of a job. You're now into, is it the second decade, third decade?
I'm getting old.
I'll ask Doc that question.
You're too young to answer it, Jude.
Sure. But you do a fabulous job, and the drill you go through with our local agencies, with integration and interface with the state and other government agencies, the private sector, supporting the Hampton Beach Village District. I think there's a lot of takeaway in terms of modes of transportation. The things spring out, why can't the state for a couple of days ride the trolley into work? Millions and millions and millions of people ride trolleys or subways to work in the city. We speak of just recently Boston. So I think it's a wonderful way to showcase the town. It's wonderful revenue. It's a beautiful beach, and it drives revenue. And I support it, and I know the town does. And I think the chamber does a magnificent, magnificent job, as does the town in our agency.
Thank you.
So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yeah.
Now, this year, how much is it to get in?
It's right now we have it at 5, 8, and 5. So Friday's 5, 8 is Saturday, and Sunday is 5. But I know that next year, knowing what our budget is, I'll be back with a $10 admission on Saturday. And we're forced to do it. I don't want to go up. I didn't want to go from 5 to 8. But we're going to have to come back with a higher admission fee.
The board really worked hard on that one to go, like she said, from 5 to 8 on Saturday.
So it's for this year, you mean?
For this year, it's 5, 8, and 5 for next year because of...
Is that the same as it was last year?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll be back, though, next year with a $10 admission fee for Saturday. And then probably something higher for Sunday. I don't know what, but we're forced to.
Yeah.
As a business, if you guys were in our business, you'd have to go up, too.
I don't think you can go to any state fair and pay less than that. So.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's just, I just like to forewarn, I like to put it out on the table because it's the unfortunate reality.
Now, did the police chief want to come up and say something?
So just quickly understand the process we've gone through for a number of years working with the festival. They've been great to work with and working out, but as we know, the world's changed today. We have far more security interests that we have to be aware of, 9/11, but now you talk about the marathon bombing, the things that we have to do to prepare for these things, and that's the important thing people have to know. These types of events take a lot of prep work, and we do not bill out for that prep work. If you look at recent events like up in Keene, the Pumpkin Festival, or if you look at the air shows in Portsmouth, all the staff time is billed out to those entities. The Boy Scouts of America held the air show. Their bill for that much smaller event, shorter event, was $50,000 just for the police coverage in the city of Portsmouth and the town of Newington. I took the time last fall to go up and attend the meeting for the planning of this, the Keene Pumpkin Fest, just to look at what other folks do, comparable events. Now, that is a one-day, eight-hour event. Of course, there's a lot of planning and staging that goes on and a lot of after stuff. And I was had the chance to speak with the chief and asked him what he billed out for the 2013 Pumpkin Fest. And it was in the vicinity of $55,000 for a one-day, eight-hour event.
Wow.
Okay. Obviously, we saw what happened out in Keene because of some of the issues. And most of the issues they deal with in Keene aren't necessarily in the event. They're in the surrounding areas, okay? Yeah. And we experienced some of that also. We experienced a lot of that last year where we were dealing with issues inside the event area, but things were occurring outside, and the people that were causing the problems were identified as just leaving the Seafood Fest. Yeah. So these things don't just, I think, if we're going to look at the good that they bring to the community, we also recognize the security risks they bring.
Yeah.
When you bring that many people into the area, there's going to be the associated problems. Most of the people are great, but we have that percentage that engage in deviant behavior, and if we're not there to stop it, it's going to become worse, and that's what we've been experiencing. Now, if you look at the history, over the last several years, because the season went out to cover Seafood Fest, we had a number of officers on detail handling the traffic in the beer tent, but we had also had scheduled on the regular schedule, which is taxpayer-funded, anywhere from 15 to 20 officers on Friday night and Saturday night, and then 10 to 15 on Saturday day and Sunday day. So We just don't have that. We can't provide it, and I have to be honest, it's also a principled item. We engage in a lot of events here in town now. It's become Event Central, and I support them. I think they're great for the very reasons that they highlighted. But the problem is our season was extended back in 2003 by then Chief Bill Wren due to the problems we were encompassing because of the scale of that event, and it was the only event in town at the time. But times have changed. Now we have all these other events, so we're also putting ourselves in a position, if we cover these with taxpayer dollars, to provide the same service to all these other events, and we just cannot sustain that. We have events almost every weekend out to Columbus Day. We have the Penguin Plunge, and I only see it expanding. With the improvements we're making down at the beach, more and more people are going to want to come down there to have their events, and I'm fine with it, as long as they're taking care of those safety points and security risks. But if we're going to engage in providing taxpayer-funded coverage for these events, we either got to do them all or we can't do any of them.
Yeah.
It's one of those things that we have to be, in my opinion, we have to be consistent with that. So that's also part of the problem. So if there's any question, I really don't, want to get into specifics of the security things that we do. I will say that I am bringing other assets in at no expense to the Seafood Fest or the taxpayers to help with some of the technology issues, the surveillance cameras and other assets that we're going to deploy this year. We had some folks in from the New Hampshire Fusion Center to help make assessments with us and offer suggestions, and we're going to act on some of those suggestions at this year's festival and at some of the other events. So we are bringing some other assets to bear at no expense to the taxpayer or to the event organizers.
Questions for the police chief? Mr. Waddell?
No, I'm set.
Mr. Bridle?
All set, thank you.
Mrs. Wells?
Great.
Mr. Bean?
Negative, sir. Thank you, chief.
No, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And now, it sounds like we've given the okay for everything from last year. Now, was there something different about the parking?
No. It's the same request as we always had.
So
we'd suggest that not be honored.
What?
We'd suggest that parking for the state employees not be honored. They have thousands of parking spaces.
Yes.
And to put them in our parking lots means that we don't make any money on those particular spots. While they're selling the spots they should be occupying on their own property.
Mm-hmm.
That's
Good.
Been a principal concern. When we renegotiated the agreement with the state, they told us very succinctly, we are not welcome to park our employees' cars on their property when we're in that area doing work. So we've basically said the same thing back.
Good.
Can I make a different request? Could I request that we park there?
No. Well, they use the Church Street lot, which is all the way the other end of town.
No, that's what I'm saying. The parking spots, the 8 parking spots that we've always had at Church Street. Can we use for our Seafood Fest employees?
That's up to the board. Again, you're not going to be able to sell those spots. Frankly, the state should be providing you spots. They're charging you an enormous fee to put this activity on and telling you can't park your employees who are necessary to run the activity.
Well, we take up the whole Ocean Boulevard parking we take up.
Well, they've only got a dozen spots down there, so...
And
they've taken our police spots, our fire spots. They've taken all the bus spots.
Yeah.
All those are all the handicapped parking spots. They're all gone.
Mm.
And yet they want to park their employees on our property, so we lose money at that. And we lose money every time we give parking away.
Yeah.
Same problem you have.
Yeah.
No, I understand.
Is there any way we could use the 8 for our setup crew or people that... I mean, we have one... We actually have one parking lot, which is so small, and it is so overbooked. So we have issues. I mean, we have...
We're out of space.
We have parking issues.
May I just ask a question, please?
Revenue
is $20 a day per spot, perhaps, for a parking spot? Times 8, it's 160. Times 3, it's $500. Are we going to quibble about $500 on a $6 million event?
So are you wanting to make a motion?
Okay, yes, that we grant 8. What 8 spots do you want, please? Help
me. It's at Church Street, which is, the further lot. And it was, we always got 8 parking spaces at Church Street parking lot.
For us.
Our employees, the Seafood Festival, Hampton Area Chamber of Commerce.
I would move that we provide 8 parking spots for the employees of the Seafood Festival at the Church Street for the duration of the event.
I'll second it.
Okay, we have a first and a second. Any discussion?
I mean, I don't want to zap the chamber or the seafood, but I agree with Fred.
Okay, so...
But the state...
Yeah?
I mean, and I agree with you. I agree with both of you, but I'm just putting that out there. I'm just saying it.
I've been doing it for 4 years. The state's got on $6 million bucks. If 80 points of that is meals and rooms, they're making $500,000 bucks in this book. We got a showstopper, and it's important to these people. And
all right.
I'm in favor.
Okay, so any other... You don't have any comments? Do you have comments? So all those in favor?
Reluctantly.
I'm opposed.
And one against. So you have...
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much. We appreciate your help. We appreciate you listening to our story as well and just understanding the details behind us. So
thank you.
We appreciate that.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming in tonight. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Moving on to the town manager's report, Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, our membership in the Southeast Regional Solid Waste District 53B ended on June 30th, 2015. The district is in the process of refunding to the town $22,835.30 that is due at the date of that closing. And I will tell you that I understand the checks have been made out and they are in the mail to us right now. So we're looking forward to depositing that into the general treasury of the town.
Good.
Public Works has been working on with our contractor for paving and improvements on Exeter Row, Belmont Circle, Fairfield Drive, and Ruth Lane. I had in here that we expect it will be completed this week, and I received an email this afternoon at 2:18. The paving of Exeter Road will be completed on Tuesday the 28th and Wednesday the 29th. So we'll be off that road as of the evening of the 29th, and that goes from Route 101 overpass to the railroad bridge in the center. So that project will be completed, which is great because that's what we need to do. Since our last meeting, I've been informed that the Place Cove Beach was closed for 2 days because of a high fecal contamination reading that was taken by the state. The warning was removed in 2 days as the new test showed water to be normal. It is noted that this is the first test in 400 prior tests that was not normal. I did talk to the state and explored this, and they felt that with the number of people down there and the number of children down there someone obviously had been going to the bathroom in the water, and it got picked up in the test because they were surprised themselves. They saw no contamination before or after that one reading, or that actually it's 2 readings. Nothing's occurred since that point in time. So we're keeping an eye on it to see what's going on down there. And, Mr. Chairman, a couple other things. You had asked, or the board had asked, that we... put on the agenda for this evening, and I said I would bring it up in my report, the question of the plaques at the fire station that was requested. And it was also requested to find out in regards to, and this may pertain to that, I don't know, but what the fees have been for this period of time, for the previous year and for the current year. And the fees in the previous year were $425, and the fees in the new year were $4,347.
That's with the fee increase.
That's with the fee increase. And that only happened since April, so that's just a few months.
Yeah, good.
So, but the plaques are kind of before you because that's something that needs to be finished.
Yes.
The chief has suggested that we might want to use aluminum plaques, which can be something a little different, and that could save an awful lot of money. But you have the money in the account for the brass plaques, and what is your pleasure, if any?
I want to discuss that.
Okay. Questions for the town manager's report, Mr. Bridle.
As far as what he brought up. I'm all set with that. I do have one question. When we go about putting a new crosswalk in, how do we do that?
It's either in conformance with the federal state standards under Metco, or it's at the request of the Board of Selectmen.
All right. I've noticed an area up in front of the, I guess it's the Inner Hampton, Best Western now.
Oh, Best Western.
Between them and the funeral home, there's a lot of activity going across the street there. Yeah. That motel's being used a lot now, mm-hmm. and there are two or three restaurants across the street. Mm-hmm. There's also that little golf course.
Yeah, yeah.
And then in the off-season, I know that when they have a large funeral and stuff, yep. a lot of the parking goes on over at the golf course. So I would like to see if we could put in a crosswalk in that area. There's one at Belmont Circle, which is up 400 feet one way, and the next way is at Tower Drive, which is probably 600 feet the other way.
Yeah.
So it's a limited distance there. I've been sitting in the restaurant and noticed people walking, a lot of people crossing the road there, and I think it's an appropriate place to put one in. And I would like to see us do that.
Okay, we'll bring that up under old business.
Okay.
We'll talk about it.
All right.
Okay, Mrs. Wolseley.
Yes. First of all, maybe the trend is changing, Fred, because if they're going in the water at Place Cove, they maybe are going to be out of Mr. Griffin's yard and people's yard when they're engaging in these activities. I gave you the Seacoast Sunday article for the fire department, which I thought was pretty outstanding. And just to mention to the public, in case they have not read the Seacoast Sunday on the danger to firefighters from cancer, and we have come a long way here in Hampton to protect the members of our department with washing the turnout gear and putting hoses on the exhaust.
Is this from the town manager's report?
Oh, well.
Okay, that's what we're talking about.
Okay. Now Public Works and the paving and improvements. Fairfield, Belmont, and Ruth are done. I took a swing through there yesterday. Beautiful job, and the residents are raving about GMI and how wonderful they were to the neighborhood. They said they were very considerate. Because it is tricky when you've got something like that going on, especially in a small neighborhood. And I told Fred the neighbors were so happy with the job that the contractors did. The sound, when we're talking about negotiating the new Comcast contract, the sound is still a problem. I tried watching the Budget Committee meeting the other night. I'm having to turn the volume up to about 40 or 50 on the television set. You shouldn't have to do that.
Okay, then bring it up under old business. Do you want to talk about the town manager's report?
Oh, okay. And all right, that's it, Fred.
Okay, Mr. Bean.
Yes, thank you. Just real quickly to you and your department heads and all the employees, summer's a surge operation. It's always surge in Hampton, but that Exeter Road project was neglected. A bid came in for $5.8 million. You kicked it back to the curb. You've got a new director. That thing's going to bear fruit real soon, and one heck of a job. You saved the taxpayers a lot of money.
Yeah.
You led in accordance with your billet, and we're very thankful to you, Mr. Welch. Good job.
Thank you for your support.
Thank you for your leadership. We appreciate it. We really do. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
We talked to the town manager's report.
I'll stick right to the report. No, Exeter Road, they did a super job because, you know, the traffic moving on there, they did a great job moving that traffic and keeping it going. I mean, there were times you had to detour, but it was really, really a good job. So, kudos to, you know, the town, the department heads, and everybody that worked with them to get that done, because it's been done really well. So, and hopefully it stands up, and it's a good job. Mm.
I had a flurry of complaints Monday, and then I called Jamie, talked to Jamie Sullivan. Fred wasn't available, and it all smoothed out after that.
Thank you for your report, Mr. Welch.
Thank you, sir.
Moving on to old business. Number one, permission for seawall reconstruction and partially located on town property. A, 32 Northeast Lane, 28 Northeast Lane, 28 Northeast Lane, 20 Northeast Lane, 16 Northeast Lane. Mr. Welch.
I think we're going to talk about Norris Lane, Mr. Chairman. I'm not sure why, but I think that's the nub of it all. This application actually came before the board on December 16th, 2013. The board tentatively approved it at that point in time. You need to do an affirmatory vote. This is going to be the construction of a seawall that's partially on private property and partially on public property. And in conformance with your prior vote, these folks have called and said, okay, we're willing to now proceed. They need to do two things. One, they need to get an approval from this board. They have an approval from conservation and from planning. And they need to follow, and I'm going to hand these out just so everybody has one. The requirements, these are the standard requirements that we had in place prior to the policy we revoked several weeks ago.
Yeah.
Because they are going to have to go on the beach in order to build some of this seawall.
Yep.
And in doing that, there are certain things they need to do, like provide insurance in case anything happens on town property and so forth. But that's, and they will have to go down through Place Cove after September 15th. Mm-hmm. They have to do it between September 15th and May 15th. Otherwise, that area is closed to construction. With the board's approval, we would like to see the seawall get built because it's important to contain that last end up by Little River all the way down onto the area of Hampton. The plans are in conformance with those approved by DES, by Planning Board, and by Conservation Commission. We'd ask your permission to proceed.
Does someone want to make the motion, or we would rather discuss it first?
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Okay, open for discussion. Mr. Bridle?
No, I think it's a good idea. I think, you know, this is some of the fruits of our labor of working through what we did in the past couple months.
Yeah.
I know there's people want to get it done. Part of this seawall is actually on their property. Part is on on the beach. I know a lot of the work, I guess, is going to be done from their property, but some did have to be done from the beach. So I think
a little bit.
It's a good situation, and I'm for it.
And you're happy with the way that we've the policy as it's been going since we've had these discussions, Mrs. Wolseley.
I talked with the town planner about this today because my one concern, and I appreciate the outline from you, Mr. Welch. I asked about the consistency of design. It looks like we have a strong probability here, since they're all adjoining properties, that the seawall revetments be constructed in the same fashion, so we don't have a problem like we have with 1042. And I asked Jason if he thinks, you know, the mood of the planning board is to have some type of consistent build there. Are you comfortable that that's going to be the case?
I am. I looked at the plans, and the walls are going to be constructed for those six pieces of property identically, all the way down. And they will meet up with the wall at the end of the six pieces of property and butt into that, so that there won't be any undue pressure brought against that wall, the other seawall, which is a different type of construction, at that seventh location.
But that's great, because I don't want to see a poorly constructed or poorly designed section of the revetments, which will jeopardize everything else that's on there. All you need is one weak link.
Oh, yeah. In this case, they're building something rather novel, because they're bringing in gigantic pieces of granite, solid blocks, and they're building the wall out of that. It's going to be a straight up and down wall. It replaces the straight wall that's there now, but it's going to look much better.
Great.
It's going to have all the accesses inside the wall, so they're protected.
Good.
So there's a lot less chance for those walls to fail.
And they won't have that little jumble of rocks that gets thrown up under their porches and
there'll be nothing but sand in front of it, and it will. And I'm assuming they'll put some heavy granite out there to break up high waves.
Excellent.
But it's going to look quite impressive when they finish with it.
And much better protection for the property, which means better protection for our property values and assessed values.
Yep, absolutely.
Excellent. Thank you.
Mrs. Wolseley, are you happy with the policy that's been determined here the last couple of months?
I am very happy.
Okay, great. Mr. Bean.
I have no comments, sir.
And are you happy with the policy that's
been
worked
happy,
out here?
I'm very happy, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
I'm
this
happy
whole
enough,
side of the
yes.
table is happy.
And you're happy, too.
Yes, happy enough, yes.
Okay. So we have a first and a second. All those in favor, unanimous. Thank you.
So this is old business.
Now
right?
we're on to old business, Mr.
Right.
Bridle.
Yeah, I'd like to make a motion that we have a sidewalk, a crosswalk, not a sidewalk, mm-hmm. crosswalk put in the area of the Best Western, Logan's Run, across yep. there. Make those people easier for those people to cross.
I'll second that.
Okay, and discussion. Mr. Bridle?
You've already said
what you said. Mrs. Wolsey?
And we're going to have another one of those great signs that Fred's got up on Route 1 that shows that there's a crosswalk. You know, those nice signs you have, the yellow signs?
The old Metro signs, yes.
I love yep. those signs. And we did this down by 401 on Lafayette
yes.
Road.
Yes, we did.
So it's a very good suggestion.
Well, I after we get by the vote, I'll bring up something else. So.
Uh-oh.
You're not going to go down there and paint them all green like they did in Bill Rock.
Well, that's what I was going to say. That's what he should
no, that
do.
That guy got in trouble. That guy doesn't do it on
that's
his own.
That's my hometown, so watch
he
out.
He used his own paint or something.
Mr. Bean.
No comment, sir.
Okay. Mr.
I'm all set. I just want to see Rusty get down and okay. paint it green.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
While we're talking on crosswalks.
Uh-oh.
If you've been over to Sagamore Avenue in Portsmouth,
yeah.
you'll see some of the new crosswalk signs they have over there.
Oh.
They are have LED lights on them. They're solar powered, so they light up. I would like to see the. I've talked to the Public Works Director briefly about this, but I'd like to see if maybe we can put one at one of our crosswalks in town. To try it and see how people like it to get an assessment. I think we can also talk with the schools and maybe do them at the schools, at the crosswalk at the school. They're about $2,000 to set up for each one. But I'd like to see us first and see the effectiveness before we decide to go out and buy a bunch of them.
Mm-hmm.
We may be able to find some people that are willing to
donate.
But I think we ought to try one at one time. So I'd like to see the at least get the Public Works Director's input on that and see if maybe we can bring that back to the board at some time.
Mm, I like that.
Well,
yeah.
Okay.
Pretty good.
Any other old business? Mrs.
Yes.
Wolsey.
Yes, of course I have old business. I don't want to disappoint you. We have had at least two emails from the chairman of the Municipal Budget Committee asking for a posture or protocol on legal expenses this is a generic request. There's nothing specific. They're not running out to spend money now. I am surprised that there has been no response. I think it's really outrageous. What do we have to do? To get, I assume, Attorney Gerald could respond to that request, probably with the same response he had on October 30th, 2012, when the question was asked by the Budget Committee then, whether they should insert a legal expense line in their budget. They have had never had one, and they do not have one now. And Attorney Gerald was present, and he said, I have money in the legal budget, and if I can't represent you, if there's a conflict with the interests of the selectmen, then we have outside counsel money in the budget. And the Budget Committee chose on a 12-1 vote to take him at his word and let the system proceed. I was the only vote that opposed because I did mention to the Budget Committee at that point in time that any legal expenditures would be subject to the will of the Board of Selectmen since they control the legal department. But sometimes people don't pay attention. So I'm assuming that Attorney Gerald's advice would be substantively the same as it was in October. But if they'd like written confirmation and we can provide that, I'd appreciate it.
Any other old business?
Yes, but may I have a response on getting back to Chairman Latimer? Is it something we can do?
We're meeting with a lawyer tonight, so you can ask.
Oh, good.
Him.
Okay, that's excellent. But I think
any
it's
other old business.
But I think it's whoever is responsible. If nothing else, I think it's very rude to not respond to an inquiry, which leads me to the inquiry from the Teamsters. We've had an inquiry from the Teamsters Union on reopening negotiations. Has that been responded to? It took a while to respond to the police union, I remember. Are we responding to the Teamsters? Somebody say something.
Well, if I can throw a stab at it, that contract expires in 2016.
Mm-hmm. Good.
I think we've got a little window of opportunity to respond, and I think we'll do what we always do, support a real energetic negotiation.
Mm-hmm. Well, we had two requests from the police department, if I recall, and before we gave a response. I think it would be nice if we just respond to people when they ask us. On the plaques for the fire stations, and I've got the chief's memos here. I do not want to see aluminum plaques. Those stations need plaques on them.
Okay, let's handle that right now.
You said under old business.
Okay, this is old business, and we're going to handle it right now. We're going to decide if it's aluminum or we're going to decide if it's
brass. Well, I want to finish.
Okay, do we have a motion here?
I will move that we provide brass plaques on both stations.
What I meant to say, do we have a consensus?
Wait a minute.
She wants brass.
Wait a minute.
What do you feel? I am handled in the meeting.
No, you're not. And what I'm telling you is I'm presenting a motion. I bother you every night.
I'm handling it, and I'm going to make sure that we're going to find out if it's brass or aluminum.
I made a motion.
Just wait a moment.
I made a motion, but I'm not through with the wording of the motion yet.
We're going to ask the other people.
I'm not through with the wording of the motion so we can discuss it. Are you open to discussing a motion? I have not completed my motion. My motion is that we pay for and install brass plaques on both Station 1 and Station 2 at the beach. I want to see substation removed from the text of the beach station plaque. And I would like to see the setup of the Board of Selectmen wording on the beach station plaque the same as it shows on the fire department headquarters plaque. The precinct commissioner's wording is fine on that, but I think the format should be the same as it is on Station 1 proposal on the last page of the chief's material that he sent to us.
Okay, now I would like to know if would anyone like to discuss this first so we know what we're seconding?
Yes.
Okay, so we're going to discuss it first.
What is the chief's recommendation?
Mr. Welsh.
The chief's original recommendation was to install brass plaques. He did give a second opinion, if you wish to save money, to use aluminum plaques, which are the same as at the police station.
What would the savings be?
About $1,000. Okay. And that includes installation.
All right, and the police station is aluminum?
Yes. That's my understanding, yes. That's what I was told.
Mr. Bridle.
My opinion before was we didn't need plaques at all, but I think that the if the police station has the aluminum plaque and it's holding up fine, and we can save $1,000, we just had to spend $1,000 put a fence up behind there.
Mm-hmm.
To do that, and in this economic times where we have a default budget, if we can save $1,000, then so be it.
So is it it's an aluminum plaque at the police station?
That's my understanding. That's what I was told.
Okay. Mr. Bean.
I have no comment.
Do you have no comment about if you...
Well, there's a motion and...
Okay, well, I'm just trying to figure out, do we want to go? We have a motion that wants to change what's been recommended.
Well, I don't support that motion.
Okay.
I have a further comment.
Mrs. Walsh.
I would expect, given the length of time that the beach station stood down there, that these stations will last this community for a very long time. And with the effort that went into getting the stations modernized and the station at the beach replaced, I think it would be an appropriate gesture for the community and for the individuals who fought so hard to get those stations put together and to get that construction accomplished. I think the brass plaques are appropriate.
So my feeling is that we should take, we have, it's already been decided by who, what's going on those plaques, Mr. Welch.
The plaques were roughed in and given to the board. There was a difference between the plaque at the central fire station, which is the new headquarters, mm-hmm. and the beach fire station, which is replacing the old fire station down there at the beach, and is no longer the headquarters. That listed the district commissioners who were in office at the time the station was built and the selectmen.
Good.
That's the only difference between the
and
two.
And it said substation, and we do not want that on that plaque.
Well, that's what was on the original plan, so we didn't change that. I mean, it doesn't make a difference to us whether it says substation or not.
The chief recommended that go, and I agree with him.
Where did he recommend that?
Right here, if you read his memos.
Yeah, it's in his memorandum.
Okay.
Yeah.
So did he recommend exactly what he would like to say?
It's right here.
He had approved that.
I read it. You don't have to tell me. We're asking the town manager so he can explain it to the public.
He did. And he did approve the original mock-ups. In fact, he's the one who had them made. So that the station uptown, Town of Hampton Fire Department headquarters
right.
dedicated December 12th, 2013.
Right.
It lists the 2013 members who served in the Board of Selectmen at that time, the mm-hmm. town manager, the fire chief, the deputy fire chief.
Right.
Then at the beach, his recommendation was to remove the word subs, or to read Town of Hampton Fire Department Beach Station.
Right.
Dedicated December 17th, 2013. The same Board of Selectmen, the 2013 Board of Beach Commissioners, mm-hmm. and the town officials.
Right.
So would someone like to make that motion that the chief recommended?
I have a motion on the table, if nobody
Well,
minds.
I don't think anyone seconded it. So
I make a motion we go with the chief's recommendation.
For?
And remove the sub.
And for brass or aluminum?
Aluminum.
Is there a second? Any further discussion? All those in favor? For? And are you abstaining or are you against?
I'm disgusted. Mark me as disgusted. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Wolseley. So moving on to,
Wait a minute, I'm still under old business, I believe.
Okay, well, keep going.
Thank you. Fred, under the your letter on the unkempt buildings or the buildings that are falling apart or whatever, I appreciated that. Are we finding more buildings that are such a hazard that they need to be torn down or dealt with, because I appreciated what you did in the most recent letter.
Well, we have to, I'll get down on my knees a little bit and say I hope not. Mm. We haven't found any. Once in a while we do find a building that's in dire condition. We do have a building that has been condemned for use, which is down on Route 1 near the Hampton Falls town line.
Oh, yes.
But that one is being slated for removal by the owner of property. So I think that'll be taken care of. We have not discovered any other buildings that are in serious condition.
By the water tower, just as you go onto.
That has been purchased by someone, and we understand that building is either going to be raised or renovated.
Oh, okay. Because you found the one or two at the beach in your letter that needed.
Right.
Because that's something you don't tend to think about. But I appreciated the action that you and the chief took on that one.
Well, once they're discovered and you know something is radically wrong and they're a danger to people going into them, you take an immediate action to secure them. And we've done that in that case. the other buildings in town that are in, shall we say, questionable condition.
Right.
Have either recently been purchased, and there are plans to either demolish or to renovate the buildings and bring them back into code.
Mm. So. And final question for the manager. The July 22nd PRC report for the planning board, and this is related to the Toll Farm, Drakeside, et cetera, projects that are being proposed. And that's really complicated. I know Chris Jacobs has been here. The planner is involved. Everybody's involved in there. But I'm wondering if there's something further we could do or should do, because now we're getting to the point where we're starting to build in really marginal areas, and it could cause a lot of problems, traffic problems, how many curb cuts, all this stuff. Have we any further recourse as they go through the planning review process? Is there any input that I know Chris Jacobs is there and the engineers, but anything you can think of that we should be doing? Because I have a horror of having something done and then we're in trouble for years and years and years.
I think we're doing all we can. That particular project has been to the plan review committee 4 times.
Right.
And it's going to have to come back again because the review committee rejected it.
Absolutely, yeah.
And there are some reasons for that, technical reasons. And the builder has said that he will come back with a new proposal. So we're working on it. But that's the best you can do, because ultimately something has to go to the planning board.
Right.
But right now the builders are being extremely cooperative in trying to get things done.
But also, why are we questioning them? I mean, there's a lot of people on there that are really expertise, the review committee there. I mean, why are we discussing that now? Why are we questioning what they're doing?
I'm not questioning what they're doing. I'm trying to figure out if there's something further we need to do or be aware of as a board, as a community, because we are starting to construct in marginal areas in this town, and there can be problems. So I know I read.
I think they're looking at that.
Every one of the reports, and I just want to make sure.
I think we all read the reports.
Nothing's slipping through the cracks.
So far, we've been very successful in holding the status quo to make sure things are done correctly and for the benefit of the community.
Yeah.
Thank you. Mm. Other old business, Mr. Bean.
Negative, sir.
Mr.
Negative.
Waddell.
No, sir.
Okay, I have some, so I was just waiting to get to
that. Wow.
I already forgot. No, it has to do with Norm Hurley, his questions that he's had about the grist mill.
We have not gone, and we have not designed the RFQ or RFP yet. That's something that's going to be done as soon as we finish with the paving projects we have going on. As you know, we're in the process of having 2 dams rebuilt. We're currently working with the Conservation Commission on the dam for Ice Pond, and I'm hoping that's going to be done in some reasonable period of time. I have talked to the builders, and they have been required to do certain things for the Conservation Commission, and we're simply waiting for those to come
mm-hmm.
in.
Yeah.
As far as the gristmill dam is concerned, there are no plans to reconstruct that dam. We're going to have to go out to an RFP or an RFQ to select an engineering firm to come in and design that work. Once that work is designed, we'll be able to get a reasonable estimate of what that cost is. Mm. And that may or may not meet the budget requirement, I can't tell you, until right. we actually get it in hand.
Yeah. So when do you expect that to be?
I expect the RFQ probably will take at least a month to develop and to go out. We'll hire an engineer after that's occurred. And I'm not expecting any remarkable activity until spring.
Mm. Yeah.
It's going to take that. There are a whole set of federal and state permits that have to be acquired mm-hmm. before you can start to move a stone up there. So it's going to take a while to get all that done.
And the other thing that I've told someone to get in touch with your office about having, I believe it's a curve sign.
It's all taken care of.
So you already heard from her?
Already heard about it.
Okay, thank you very much. And that's proof that when people do call up, like I told that lady, to get in touch with your office, we want to help.
It's all scheduled.
Everybody wants to help.
It's all scheduled. It'll be taken care of.
That's what we're all about. Moving on to new business. Number one is the Sewer Access Fund. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, as you know, the board had created a Sewer Access Fund, and we have some dollars in there that have been deposited. There are three major projects on the immediate list for 2015, the first three. There are four or five more that we will eventually be coming in with, but the first three to be done is the HVAC system improvements within the wastewater treatment plant. For those of you who have frequented that building, and I hope that's not many, there is a very heavy and distinct odor of sulfur in the building that needs to be remedied. And that means that the HVAC systems have to be repaired or replaced. And the cost to bring it into code is $15,000. We have that money.
If it's a smell of sulfur,
okay, we're going to have
an exorcism.
Well, I'm not sure about the exorcism, but we've thought about several things close to it. Number two is an emergency generator replacement for the Merrill Drive pumping station, which is $20,000. Mm-hmm. That particular generator is 30 years old.
Wow.
And has been giving us trouble as far as failing is concerned. And we're concerned that if that's not replaced immediately, that we could have an environmental problem there. Mm. And the third item is to replace one of the drives in the raw sewer effluent pump stack that we have three drives down there, and they are variable drives. This one needs to be replaced. The other two need to be replaced probably in the following year, and the cost of that is $8,100. The total is $43,100 to be expended. This board, as a sewer commissioner, control that fund, and there is well over $150,000 in the fund currently. You
could
authorize.
Mr. Waddell?
No.
Mr. Waddell?
I will so move.
Let's.
I will make a motion so we can discuss it. I will move that we accept.
Okay. Does someone want to second her?
I'll second it.
Motion. Okay. Mr. Waddell?
I'm fine.
Okay. Mr. Bridle?
No, I think it's about time we replace that down there as George Carter always used to say, poop stinks. And
it does.
You need to get that building so that the ventilation is in there so it's acceptable for our employees that are in that building.
So. Mrs.
It's not
Wolfley.
Just a bad odor. It's toxic with that sulfur. And the employees deserve a safe environment. And I'm delighted. And I had a chance to speak briefly with Fred this morning. And I will say publicly what I said to him this morning. Had he not brought up the sewer buy-in concept several years back, I wouldn't have decided that it was a darn good thing to do and push to get that charge in. This is great, and we're starting to reap the benefits now of charging people for the new hookups and for the use of the sewer. So I think this is terrific, and I really appreciate it.
If I could just have Mr. Chairman, the town manager, articulate the formal motion, because I'm not clear, and I don't think the public is exactly what the motion is.
The formal motion would be to, excuse me, the selectmen to authorize a withdrawal from the sewer access fund in the amount of $43,100.
Excellent.
For the repair of HVAC improvements for the wastewater treatment plant for $15,000. The replacement of the emergency generator at the Merrill Drive pumping station for $20,000. And the replacement drive for the raw sewer effluent pump, one of three, for $8,100.
And who seconded that?
Rusty did.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Next, we have the 2015 to 2010 heavy-duty pickup truck. Purchasing policy waiver from 718-4, period B, period 3. Mr. Welch.
That's a lot of periods and all kinds of other good stuff. Mr. Chairman, this was bid out. And you can see from the recommendation that you received that the town of Hampton accept the bids for the heavy-duty pickup truck. Liberty Chevrolet was the lowest responsible bidder to submit a bid for the item requested. Liberty Chevrolet has the qualifications, experience, and reputation to perform the services necessary for the town of Hampton in a timely fashion in reference to the town's purchasing policy. We recommend the town accept the bid submitted by Liberty Chevrolet, and that the recommendation for the award does not comply with the Town of Hampton purchasing policy, section 718-4, subsection B2, because there were fewer than three qualified bidders.
Okay, Mr. Bridle.
I know there were fewer than three. That doesn't mean, however, that we sent bid requests out to just the two, correct?
No, we sent them to considerably more.
We just only had two.
We only had two that responded.
Two that responded, yeah. Correct. I just want the public to know that we're not just going to two, mm-hmm. but I know that the Public Works Director sent out numerous requests.
Thank you. Mrs. Wellesley?
I think it should be pointed out that a 2005 a Chevrolet 2500 pickup was traded in, and that trade-in amount was $6,500, so that's a good recoup as well.
Right.
Who's going to be using this truck, Fred? Do we know what
I believe it's the sewer and drain.
Sewer and drain, okay.
And Mr. Bean?
Negative, sir.
Mr. Waddell?
Negative.
Does somebody want to make a motion?
Make the motion that we accept the Public Works Director's request for the bid waiver on this 2015 heavy-duty pickup.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Three, bid 2015 to 2012 service body purchasing policy waiver from 718-4 period B period 3. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, exactly the same thing. This is the body that goes in the truck.
So this is sewer as well.
This is sewer. This represents a sewer charge, and the cost goes into the sewer department for purchasing equipment. This body is needed to replace the existing body. Both the truck and the body are completely gone, but there are only two bidders.
Does someone want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion that we go with the Public Works Director's recommendation on bid 2015-012. With Candia trailers and equipment for the truck body.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Four, amend Chapter 545, Ambulance Article 1, Ambulance Write-Offs.
Now, Mr. Chairman, we'd ask this be postponed to another meeting. There's a lot more information that I need to give you that I have not yet had an opportunity to perfect and give you.
Good.
So that
thank you.
This needs to go on.
Five, amend Chapter 805, Vehicles and Traffic, Article 3, Parking Regulations. A 805-20, no parking areas. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, this is a result of our continuing look at the Beach District. And the problems that we have down there, you know, I will pass these out because I think everybody needs to see exactly what we're talking about. We're talking about the area off of Brown Avenue, which includes Badcock Avenue, Susan Lane, Joanne Lane, Diane Lane, Bittersweet, Wall Street,
wow.
Page Lane.
Good.
We've had the police and fire departments go in there and take a serious look at what's going on. I went down myself. I've been down there twice. I turned in Batcock Avenue off of Island Path, and there is parking allowed, as you can see it on the west side of the street. You can see how that front section of the street contracts down remarkably.
Yeah.
There is parking allowed on the west side, which is as you're looking at the plan, the side of the street to your left. When I went in there, there were SUVs parked all along that side of the road. I could barely get my car down through the other side. Yeah. So that's part of the reason for this. Susan Lane, there were cars parked on both sides. Joanne Lane, cars parked on both sides. We went to the police and fire departments. They looked at all these streets, and we came back with this recommendation for all these streets. Page Lane, there'd be no parking. Fire Lane, tow zone on the north side of the street for its entire length. Mm-hmm. Wall Street, no parking. Fire Lane, tow zone on the north side of the street for its entire length. The same for Bittersweet Lane, Diane Lane, Joanne Lane, Susan Lane, and Batcock. Now, Batcock already has a restriction on part of the street, and that restriction is that there's no parking from number 24 Batcock to number 15 Joanne Lane for a distance of 94 feet. Mm. Susan Lane actually does not carry through. It ends right there at that last lot where the town line, the two town lots begin.
Yeah.
So when you come down from come down Batcock Avenue and you get to the end, which is at Joanne Lane, that there's no parking from in front of that house immediately across from Joanne Lane, around the corner onto Joanne Lane and down to the first house. That's so vehicles can make that turn, fire trucks and ladder trucks.
Oh, yeah.
And it's important to do that. Those would be the restrictions on those particular streets. And once we put them into effect, like the streets on the other end of town and off of Ashworth Avenue, we'll go and periodically review to see whether or not they're working or need to be adjusted.
Good.
Okay.
Want a motion?
Does anyone have any other comments about it? No? Okay. And you want to make the motion, Mrs. Wellesley?
I will be happy to do that. We doing number five first, or do you want to do both together?
Let's do both together.
All right. Five and six. Amend Chapter 805, Vehicles and Traffic, Article 3, Parking Regulations, No Parking Areas, and amend Chapter 805, Vehicles and Traffic, Article 6, Fire Lanes. And I will so move that we approve the suggestion of the manager.
Any questions? All in favor? Unanimous.
It was good work, Fred.
And we're going to be into a...
Yes, Mr. Chairman, if you wouldn't mind, I'd appreciate a motion by a member of the board to go into a non-public session under RSA 91-A:3, Roman 2, small c, matters which, if discussed in public, would likely affect adversely the reputation of any person, and e, consideration or negotiation of pending claim for litigation.
Did you make that motion, Rusty?
I will make that motion happily.
Yeah.
And this is Wellesley second.
If we might have a roll call vote, Mr. Chairman.
Aye.
Okay.
Thank
you.
And I think
before we do that, do we want to close this meeting, or do we want to...
You would.
We're not going to come back.
You would recess it, potentially to come back, but likely not.
I'll second Rusty for right. Recessing at whatever time it is.
21:35.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
I always rely on the military. There.